doesn't matter. It only seems like it does.
Hey, what's up? Welcome to this video. You probably already know what it is by the title, but this is actually really, really important, more important than you might think. Honestly, a lot of times it could be as crucial as your content taking off or not being seen at all, just based on your thumbnail. Okay, so what makes a good thumbnail? The main thing with a thumbnail is you have to look at it as, first of all, you need to get the eyeballs onto your thumbnail. The way you do that is, again, with the hook. So that initial stage is literally focusing it down. And then once you have that attention, you need to keep it long enough for a click, meaning that once your thumbnail is seen, it needs to not just stand out, but it needs to also say something. It needs to set certain level of stakes. It needs to give a certain amount of information, a certain amount of tease. And that's what's gonna give you that click. Thumbnails are important. Okay, we get it. But now, how can we make important looking thumbnails? I was trying to make a segue, that didn't really work, but let's just make good thumbnails and let's talk about how we can do that in Photoshop. Now, and you're about to see what a difference it is to actually use a tablet that you can draw on to create your thumbnails rather than just clicking around in a very jagged way with your cursor and your mouse. So huge shout out to XP Pen. That's what I'll be using. So if you're curious, because I know I'm gonna get questions, because this tablet, as you're about to see, is amazing. Just know that I'm using the XP Pen 15.6 inch Pro. I think it is, but it's a pro one. It's a tablet you could draw on it. That's what matters. And it also has custom buttons. We're gonna look at all that. One of the benefits are these buttons right here on the pen itself. Is it gonna focus? Oh, it did it for a second. Stand out. Ah, it picks up my face right away. Okay, cut the B-roll. Okay, so it has these like buttons on the side here, which are, I mean, amazing. Just to have that quick access as you're drawing, and you don't even have to move your hand or do nothing. You can literally, as you're going, switch to, for example, an eraser and start erasing things. But you can have a lot more control of what you're doing right within the tablet because it has these 8 buttons that you can customize. It's pretty crazy. And then also you have this dial wheel here, which is great because sometimes you want certain functions not as a pressable button, but you actually want a dial feel because, for example, brush size, it's a lot more intuitive to use a dial that you can spin to increase or decrease that brush size. And again, it all fits so well because if you're right-handed, or it doesn't matter which way because you can flip the tablet, but let's say you, like me, you're right-handed, you're drawing with your right hand, and then you can just have access to all these things with your other hand. And the way you start moving with things like this in Photoshop, it becomes lightning fast. So let's jump into Photoshop and let's see how we can take things up a notch. And that's from the first thing that we're gonna talk about right now, which is adding graphic weight, adding separation, and adding contrast and depth between the elements that are in your thumbnail to, again, add a sense of dimension. And I'm gonna just bring that thumbnail in here. And because I have a pen, I can actually trace the edges and actually give them a little bit of an edge light that wasn't there, or that was there, but that we can actually enhance what is in the scene to, again, make it pop even more. Yeah, just kind of draw those outlines as best as you can. And we're gonna take a few copies of this and we're gonna play with a little bit of blurring. And I'm gonna keep adding masks once that effect is applied so I can actually delete parts of it or hide parts of it within the mask so that the blurring edge stays within the subject and doesn't go outside its border, because that looks more like a glow and we don't want that. We're trying to edge light him. So the main thing to focus on here is that we're trying to literally draw on edge, just like you would in a cartoon or a graphic. You're just literally trying to draw something that can outline in a way that separation that is happening from something that is in your foreground to the rest of your background, which may not be as important. And yeah, we can already tell a big difference here. Just for me quickly doing it right now as an example, you can see that now the subject stands out quite a bit more, and this image is a lot easier to read, just because before it already, you know, tonally, we're dealing with a lot of similar contrasts. It's a pretty wide shot, so you don't have out of focus, blurry background. It wouldn't really make sense for this type of shot. So using this way of using light and outlining is a great way to add that sense of separation. You could probably make a lot of your thumbnails pop just on that alone, but let's make them pop even more. But the main idea here is that you duplicate your footage. We're gonna pretty much isolate our subject just by using a mask. So we're gonna literally draw and isolate him from the rest of the background. And once we have those two layers separated, we can go in the background layer, which should be below this new layer that you isolated. And in there, we can apply whatever blurring effect pleases your heart. Literally, it could be just a simple Gaussian blur, however way you say that. Or it could be a directional blur, you know, depending on the type of effect and blurring that you would like. Play around with them. You can use, obviously, the lens blur, which is the most accurate one in Photoshop. And there you go, you're set. You got a fake depth of field that you've added later on into your image, which, again, creates a really nice separation. Now, you know, you have to pick and choose when you're using this, but it's a very powerful tool to have. And just as we did with blurring the background, we can also just sharpen the foreground, or the main element that we want people to pay attention to. So I'm gonna actually take away the blur effect, and I'm actually gonna select the top layer of our subject, and I'm gonna add unsharp mask to that layer. And I can play around with these settings. There's a very useful preview checkbox that you can check and uncheck just to get a sense of what the before and after is of what you're affecting in your image. And once you find a good spot, don't go too crazy, because you might have some nasty haloing effect if you go too hard on this. But once you find that sweet spot, you can definitely tell that you can make a lot of your thumbnails stand out way more just by adding more sharpness and detail to the parts that matter. I really love this like fog or haze filter because it's another very quick way of adding that separation, literally in a few clicks. You don't even have to isolate the subject or isolate the things that you want to. The AI and Photoshop will just know, which is pretty crazy where things are going. But of course, you can take these principles. For example, if you don't have the latest version of Photoshop or whatever the case is, you can still use that initial trick that we just saw with separating the subject from the background, and you can literally add a gray solid or a bluish solid and add it as a tint to the background and lower the transparency, and that can be another way of adding that separation. The main thing with the idea of separating things is, again, just making it easy on the eyes and dialing it in. Working in this way, you're gonna be like, why was I using a mouse for this stuff all along, all this time? That's what I'm asking myself, to be honest. My name is Chris Trini for Chris Guar, and I'll see you next time.